गुड मॉर्निंग एवरी वन. ट्रस्ट यू ऑल आर डूइंग वेल एंड कीपिंग सेफ. वी स्टार्टेड कोविड जानकारी विद द सोल इंटेंशन ऑफ प्रोवाइडिंग वैलिडेटेड इंफॉर्मेशन, रिसोर्सेज एंड ऑन ग्राउंड सपोर्ट टू दोज इन डिस्ट्रेस ड्यूरिंग द पैंडेमिक. आर स्टेट वाइज कम्युनिटीज हैव ओवर 50,000 पीपल असिस्टिंग वन अनदर, बैक्ड बाय अराउंड 250 डिजिटल वॉलंटियर्स टू मैनेज देम एफिशिएंटली. टू बेटर ऑर्गेनाइज दीज वॉल्यूम्स, we have now built a tech-led crowdsourced matching platform to brace up for the future waves of COVID and beyond. We have tied up with pool of doctors across India to provide teleconsultation to our communities to ensure they get timely help and avoid any kind of self-medication. While our objective is to improve accessibility for everyone, we are also looking to subsidize the consultation fee for people in need. Apart from this, we have tied up with Zomato's Feeding India initiative to serve food for the street dwellers and animals during lockdown across various cities in India to support them. I'm Swati Khandelwal, founder of Exenius Health, and today I welcome to the next edition of our flagship Health Jankari series. Today we have Dr. Nitin. Welcome, Doctor. We are so glad to have you today. Let's talk health.
Thanks, Swati. It's my pleasure to be here with you.
Over to Apurva and Sumiran.
Hi, Doctor. I'm Sumiran. So for a brief introduction for the doctor, Dr. Nitin is an orthopedic surgeon and director of Prime MS Healthcare for the past 11 years. He is an alumni of Pandit Ravi Shankar Shukla University and IIM Ahmedabad and IIM Bangalore. His vision is to promote a team-based, patient-centric, reliable, integrated, multidisciplinary, ethical, and economical healthcare for masses in India and delivering value to organization, medical fraternity, and society. And thank you, Doctor, for joining us today.
It's my pleasure, Sumiran.
Let's just getting straight to the questions and everything. One of the first questions we received was like, I have suffered from COVID, but now that I've recovered, I have severe joint pain. Is there a connection between this disease and me getting these pains?
It's quite common, Sumiran, that in the post-COVID times, typically for 6 to 12 weeks, the patient could have one of myalgias or you can say that generalized body weakness. The typical question you have asked is a joint pain. Typically, most of the people confuse joint pain with a muscle pain or myalgias. Myalgias are very common in a post-COVID and they are self-limiting. And they just don't require much of the medications that required usually the typical small basic exercises you need. And sometimes if that is bothering you, you might need a milder form of NSAIDs or a paracetamol that will take care of. But there are few cases where you could have a joint swelling or the typical joint pain. You have a pain around your joints and typically associated with a swelling or a redness. I think that's a red flag and you should consult your doctor for that. And you should not try to self-medicate on that side.
Yeah, being self-medication is one thing which you have to stop, at least in our country for sure. Then the next question is there any side effect of COVID vaccine on bone health?
Typically, that's the answer is an absolute no. And whatever that myths are surrounding that you would have a bone or a joint issues with COVID vaccination, I think that myth to be negated. And people should freely join the vaccination drive to protect ourselves, our family, our country for that. Because these myths and miscommunications are taking people away from the vaccination. And from the bone and the joint side, typically there is no serious side effect as reported with the COVID vaccination. What you could get is a flu-like myalgias for a couple of days. That's a self-limiting and possibly you will need a single dose of a paracetamol or a second dose of a paracetamol within 48 hours to 72 hours. That's all that you can expect post-COVID in a musculoskeletal system.
Thank you, doctor. And then while working from home, what can people do to maintain their healthy bones?
Typically, people who are working from home, now it's in a, you can say that in a new culture, our society is getting adopted. For working from home is, you can say that all the good practices or the disciplines of the healthy body, like good exercise routine, your sleep pattern should be good. And while you are working from home, you should have on a proper, you can say that working desk environment for your working. That what is recommended, and you should follow the diet what you needed, your exercise routine to be very disciplined, and your desk routine or the ergonomic behavior that you need to understand, and any sort of you can say that your body is aching or some pain is reported while you are doing some chronic repetitive activity. That needs to be reported, and root cause need to be understand, so that you can work on a root cause rather than taking analgesics or NSAIDs of your own.
I think my next question is the follow up. This, like, what can be then ideal the setup which you were talking about? What is the kind of ideal, the distance, the kind of chair which can help people already with the problems, and for us who have not developed any problems yet.
Yeah, typically, Sumiran, that any working environment, whether you are working in an office or the home, the principles remain the same. The thing is that while you are working in the office, your employer is responsible for giving you a safe and ergonomic working environment. Now, the responsibility is falling on you when you are working from home. So, typically, our homes are not architecturally designed in that way that you should have in a separate room for you can say that working from home. And now it is that culture is coming up, the new architectural designs of the home are taking care of the area where you can build a small work from home office kind of an environment. So typically right now most of the people don't have that kind of a setup ready with their home. So you need in a very good room, ventilated room, where you could have a sunlight, where you would be devoting your almost 7 to 8 hours minimum while you're working from home. So that setup needs to be done. I think most of the corporates are funding that work from home furnitures for that also. That's a good initiative most of the companies are taking. Typically that the thing that you have to take care of is a good desking solution, a good desking solution and a good seating solution that what your body needs is. So on a desking side, I would not recommend you to be seated for an 8 hours and doing your job. So a desking solution, if you that gives you a modularity where you can work while sitting, and that have a comfort of working within a standing position as well. So if your desking solution gives you that modularity, that is good enough. And for the seating solution, you can say that the chair that what you are sitting on, that needs to support your spine. Spine curves should be supported. That should have a lumbar support. Your seating height should be adjustable. You should have back seat lock arrangement with you, so that you can recline while you are working on desk. You should try to sit on a 90 degrees, and a good chair should have a headrest that should have a adjustable headrest, and should have an armrest with you can say that, so that you can put your forearms or the wrist or parallel to the floor, and that should have a cushion inbuilt. So these are the seating solutions that should look for while you are doing your continuous job. And the working desk or the monitor height, that should be adjusted to your eye level. Ideally, what is recommended is the monitor should have the top of a monitor and the bottom of a monitor should make an angle of 45 degrees to your eyes. That's roughly, you can say that upper edge should be at a level of your eyes. these are the some basics that you should take care of.
Thank you, doctor. That was very informative. I think we might have to, since people are still joining, I think we should take it up towards the end of the session once again. So the next question can be, what is worm's shoulders and how can it be reversed?
I think I will take this question as an a mom's orthopedic problem rather than a mom's shoulder, because I think you have specifically asked mom's shoulder. I think let me come to that first. After that, I will take other of the specifics orthopedic issues that moms are facing. The orthopedically, you can say that the shoulder pain or the pain in the back of shoulder or on a shoulder tip. These are the typical pain that is happening post-pregnancy in the females. And they have been linked to typically the postures they are taking during breastfeeding. That's the number one thing. And typically the breastfeeding during night, and they take an abducted arm and take baby's head on the shoulder. That kind of a situation they take. So these typical postures lead to a shoulder issue. And the other thing is that the cause of the shoulder pain is typically moms take baby on a particular side only. Suppose that somebody is a right-handed, they will try to pick the baby on the left side. In the mom's shoulder, the non-dominant sides usually get affected. So these are the typical shoulder related issues that happened on the mom's shoulder side. And I think during pregnancy, the hormonal level get up and your body gets relaxed. Most of the ligaments are relaxed and your flexibility increased during pregnancy time. That's a natural gift ladies get during the pregnancy. But once the pregnancy has been over, that hormones typically go on a decreasing trend. So the flexibility of the body started going down. So the females may have some of the stiffness issues that are related to that hormonal decrease, that you can say. And typically for the resolving that the shoulder pain, I would recommend that most of the people would get relaxed only with the simple stretches that you recommend. Simple upper spine exercises, neck exercises, or the shoulder shrugs, or you can say that when you put your arms, you can say that you put your both the palms behind your head and try to stretch your elbows and take that behind, so that your shoulder blades are coming near to each other. So these are the stretches that can relieve these shoulder pains, and the shoulder shrugs that can also relieve the mom's shoulder pain. And typically the neck exercises, set, you can take that. You can say that taking chin down, chin up, ear to shoulder right, ear to shoulder left, then chin to shoulder right, chin to shoulder left, and then the rotation of the neck. These are the simple steps that can relieve the mom's shoulder pain. And typically the feeding on the alternate sides, and typically while you are sleeping on the bed, you can change your side from right to left also. That can also relieve that typical chronic strain on one shoulder while you breastfed on a night time. I think these are the simple tips that can take care of mom's shoulder.
Thank you, doctor. How can neck pain caused because of hunching on the laptop be reduced? Because I think because of work from home, there's also a lot of time management issues. Like we are people who are working, they're working a lot many hours than they should be. So because of the hunching, how can that neck pain be reduced?
Typically, I think a laptop is not meant for a long duration working. I think the people who are on a long-term working schedules, they might need to shift to the desktop versions. That's my personal opinion. And if you don't have an opportunity to shift to the a desktop mode, I think on a laptop issue, The basic, the ergonomic behavior is the similar, whether you are sitting with a desktop or a laptop. I think the one more thing that is getting increased in the laptop is the laptop height issue. I think you need a docking station or to get an height at the eye level. I think that's the best thing that you should do. Or the secondary monitors you can use with the laptops so that your height of the display is at a level of your eyesight. So I think, and the other thing is working with the laptop, the major issue what we see in our clinical practices is most of the people start using laptop on bed, on a reclined positions. I think that's not good for the neck or the lower back as well. And the other thing is the people start using laptop while lying on abdomen. So these are the major things that laptop is giving you the postural mechanical pain. I think awareness of these positions and avoiding them would be the best I could suggest.
So then there is this question that there's some belt which has on Amazon saying that when you work from home scenario, like it helps keep your back straight. So do these things, these kind of belts work, and is it worth investing and buying them?
So then typically I don't suggest any of the orthotics or the braces without a medical physiotherapist or the doctor's advice. Because these are a temporary measures. You can say that our body has been made of a skeleton, that's in your core, that's a spine. And God has given you two sets of muscles that keep them balanced. Okay. And whenever there is an issue, you had that anchor issue, either your front muscle or the back muscles don't work simultaneously, or there is a power imbalance on that side. And suppose you use those belts for a temporary measures in the long term, typical that muscles which are active, which their power will get reduced, that you don't typically want in the long run. Typically in the long run, you want that your skeleton should be balanced by your muscles only. So if you are just getting it to get on a temporary relief, if you have it in a trauma and that kind of a setup and your doctor is advising you to use any brace or orthosis, that is recommended. But for a routine use, I will not recommend. Rather, I will recommend to talk to your physio or a doctor to understand that what kind of an exercises that you will need to balance your balancing your muscles and strengthening them. I think that's in a long-term measure that could help you in a better way.
Thank you, doctor. The next question is, how important is exercise for people with arthritis, especially during COVID?
I think if we take on a typical arthritis, I think arthritic people should be very cautious about the kind of exercises they would be doing. And typically what in the clinical practice, we see that during lockdown, there is an increased interest in the home-based exercises or a yoga protocols by the patients or in general, all the people. But typically with the arthritis people, we don't recommend any of the asanas. Typically, if you have an arthritis of the knee, we don't recommend any of the asanas. You should do whatever that simple breathing kind of an exercises while sitting on a chair that is recommended. And for the arthritis people, we recommend usually that non-weight bearing exercises or the simple joint motion exercises. And the basic principles remain the same, that whenever you have any joint pain or any movement that is causing pain to your joint, that activity needs to be restricted, and you should get the exercise protocol under guidance.
So, doctor, you said that like arthritis of the knee. So, can you please also explain that what actually is arthritis and can it affect other body parts as well?
No, typically, Sumiran, that arthritis, what we define as you can say that you in a joint. In a bones and you have a soft cartilaginous tissues that typically give you the frictionless movement of the joint. and there is a surrounding covering of that joint that we call it as a membrane of the joint. That's in the synovial membrane of the joint that you typically have. And in arthritis, what happens that typically that soft cartilage part of the bone that is getting destroyed due to various reasons. Arthritis, we usually define it as a primary. That is, you can say that that is happening by its own due to, you can say that degenerative thing, that with the aging, that tissue is getting degenerated. So typical, that is a most common issue while most of the aged people have a knee pain that typically belong to the osteoarthritis category. And the other category that we defined as a secondary, where you find an other cause, primary cause, which lead to that cartilage damage. Typically that rheumatoid arthritis, that's an typically inflammation of a joint due to an autoimmune kind of a disorder. Or you could have a trauma where the mechanical alignment of a joint is disturbed, and that is leading to the cartilage damage. So these are the basic two kinds of an arthritis that you can say that's one is primary and the other is secondary, where the other causes lead to the degeneration of joint cartilage.
Thank you, doctor. So doctor, before we asked about the neck pain, so is there a difference between neck and cervical pain, and what precautions can be taken by the current generation, like who have just started working from home, who spend most of their time on laptop, to avoid developing cervical?
Basically, I think it's on the common, you can say that narration that we use, a neck pain or a cervical pain. I think both are more or less same. Sometimes that happens that neck pain or cervical pain, you get a pain around your shoulder blades, or you can say that in between them. That is below your neck, but origin is from the neck region. Typically, the neck region, we can say that you would find a small hump on your neck. That's what we call it as a C7 vertebra. So above that is in a cervical region. We typically label that as in a cervical region. And any pain above that is originating is labeled as in a cervical pain. But sometimes we get a pain below that region, but origin is from above C7. So you get a referred pain around your scapular blade that also had a root in the cervical region. And now coming to your question that people who are working from home, that nowadays our most of the activities are, you can say that our neck is either down or up front side. And what is our neutral position of the body is our head or the neck is aligned with your torso on a straight line. Suppose that, and if you see yourself on mirror on insides, you will see that most of the people would have nowadays would have a head that is protruding forward. It is not aligned with your shoulder. Normally we see that is happening on the our head, is because most of the activities we are doing nowadays, we try to have tilt our head forward. So basically that's in a misaligned posture that leads to, you can say that shortening of our neck muscles, that leads to, in a longer term, shortening of the leg muscles or the.
Sorry, doctor, got muted. Can you please repeat?
Yeah. I have been telling that most of the activities nowadays we are doing are the neck and the head forward activities we are doing. With these activities, our muscles which are in the neck get shortened or stiff, and muscles on the backside of the neck, they get lexed. So this is a typical, you can say that a ball is sitting in your, in the body, which is forwardly, you can say that has a forward tilt. And most of the problems that are happening due to that only. So in a long run, you need to have the neck extension exercises you have to do, and you try to strengthen your neck extension muscles and try to stretch the neck flexors. So the neck, the front of the neck muscles, which usually get stiff, you try to stretch them. I think maintaining the flexibility of that will relieve your neck pain in the long run.
Thank you, doctor. Then this is a question. It was speculated that, especially during the first wave of the COVID, that anti-inflammatory medicines should be taken for joint pain. And it was also speculated that it can be taken for COVID and people started kind of self-medicating them. So what is your comment of, regarding that?
I think, Sumiran, there are two issues that were related to in the earlier wave of COVID, that whether you should take an NSAIDs for the myalgias or the bone pain associated with the COVID. I think you wanted to ask that question specifically.
Yeah, NSAIDs, like, are they the non-steroid anti-inflammatory? I don't know the whole
term. Yeah. Basically, that's in a non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs that what we label as an, in a short form as an NSAIDs. This typically is a wide group of painkillers that are used for a purpose of subsiding the pain and reducing the inflammation in the body. So the typical issue that have arise earlier in the first wave of the COVID is whether you should take any NSAIDs for the COVID joint pain or a myalgia, or whether you would be taking only the paracetamol. So earlier we have a fear that if we take an NSAIDs in a COVID infection, they will try to exaggerate the COVID, or the mortality would be more. That was the apprehension in the first wave. So people have been suggested that you should avoid the NSAIDs and try to take only the paracetamol. But now the data we have gathered that the basically that hypothetical fear that has came with that NSAID use in the COVID was that with the NSAIDs you have an AC receptors upregulation, which is, you can say, that the entry gate for a COVID in the tissues. So there was an hypothetical issue that NSAIDs lead to AC receptor upregulation. And number two, if you take the NSAIDs, you will mask the symptom of COVID. So you will delay approaching to the doctor, and your symptoms would be, you can say, that suppressed, and you would be reporting late to the hospitals in the COVID. But now the evidence-based data we have that NSAIDs used in COVID is not associated with increased mortality or any issues. The only caveat is that in any viral infection in children, you should avoid the use of aspirin. In children, that should be avoided, because there is a very rare disorder that affects the liver and the brain that we call it as a Reye's syndromes. That may happen as a possible adverse effect to the aspirin use in children in a viral illnesses. I think that point should be noted only. Otherwise, whatever NSAID or a painkiller your doctor is advising, you can take freely, simple paracetamol. And if that is not relieving your pain, ibuprofen or naproxen will work in a better way.
Thank you, doctor. Then there is this question, since there's a lot of difference between a child and an adult, and even the children, the first, second standard children are also attending online classes. So is there a different set of routine or a difference in nutrition for them, which is usually there for them also, so that they do not develop any of these kind of issues?
Typically, I'm very happy that you brought in these issues, because I think in our society that issue is been hugely neglected. And I think now the most of the houses or our homes are not designed to have an area where we could have a very good ergonomic arrangement for kids, where they can attend the online classes. And I think for adult and the people who are working in the corporate sector or working from home, I think they are more or less aware about the ergonomics of the desking or the seating solutions. But our kids are not aware of that, how they should be doing the online classes. And this subject has been neglected by the teachers and the schools as well, because everybody was thinking that this online classes behavior is in a a few months job, I think then the online classes would be starting. And what we could foresee is that these online classes for kids are going for long. And now we have to take a serious call on how our kids would be taking the online classes. I think first our teachers and the schools needs to be educated and trained about the needs, how the online classes should be taken. And one thing I would like to bring to highlight here is that now most of the kids are doing online classes on mobile. I think if I say a ballpark number, I think it would be more than 80 to 90% of the kids are taking online classes on the mobile. I think that's a typical no. That's a typical no from a orthopedic point of view, because you could not have an ergonomic positions or the neutral position of the body with the mobile. So you can say that this position would be worse than using what we could say that most of the corporate world is using laptop. You fear a laptop use. I think this position of using mobile while learning is a worse position that we could have. I think our kids needs to be shifted to a desktops for a learning environment. And if not, you can say that you should have a laptop with a proper desking and seating arrangement that I have already narrated the precautions that you should take care of. That while sitting, your posture should be in a 90 degree. Your thigh should be parallel to the floor. While you are working on a keyboard or mouse, your arm should be rested on an armrest, and that should be parallel to the floor. And while you are using the keyboards, normally what happens that we put the keyboards on the table, and typically our wrist get the friction from the edge of the table, whether that is in a sharp edge or a rounded edge. I think that's the worst position of the wrist that could have. That typically leads to the wrist issues and the problem with the tendons and the nerve, that what we typically is a carpal tunnel syndrome, that what we typically get with that position. And for the kids, the height of the table and the chair needs to be adjusted. So that you might need a docking kind of a thing, or you need a laptop tables, you can say that overhead tables you have to use. So that needs an individual attentions, because the typical desk heights or the seating heights, these are made with the consideration of an adult data, or the you can say that they are made for the adult, and we don't have you can say that particular kids age table or a seating solution available in the market. So what we try to get is a modular seating height or a modularity in the desking solution. That is a need for our kids if that online behavior is going for longer term.
Actually, my next question was about carpal tunnel syndrome only. So I'll just kind of follow up on that. So how you have explained it well, just once more for adults specifically, that how can this be avoided during a work from home situation?
That typical desking and the seating solution you wanted to
the
know?
The carpal tunnel syndrome and specifically for that.
You can say that first you need to understand that what is carpal tunnel. That a carpal tunnel is an area, you can say that a tunnel like area, that is a fibrocartilaginous area in our front of the wrist. You can say that where your hand starts on the, you can say that where typically your hand rests on the keyboard. That's the typical area where a carpal tunnel is there. And that is very, in a diameter wise, that's a very, you can say that crowded area. A lot of tendons and nerve go inside from your forearm to the wrist from that area. And what typically happens that if we have a repeated friction or frictions on that area, our tendons get swollen or our nerves get swollen or inflamed. So with that, you have a tingling like sensation in your forearm. In your hands, typically the fingers thumbs, index, and the middle finger. And you might feel a weak grip or weakness in the hand. So these are the symptoms that carpal tunnel could have. So to avoiding that, you have to come to the basics that you have to have the ergonomically designed chair with an armrest. Your keyboard should be on a, you can say that in line with your forearm. It should not be elevated, and you should avoid the habit of putting your keyboard on the edge of a table where you have your desktop is there. So you could have a keyboard tray arrangement, or you could use a smaller version of a keyboard to avoid that. And your mouse should be near to your keyboard. These are some of the activities that you can plan so that your elbow and forearm are resting on a cushioned armrest, and you should avoid any edges placed over the wrist area to avoid friction. And if you don't have that opportunity of either keyboard tray, you should have a cushioned pad. So that a cushion padding could be used over under the mouse when you are using the mouse, and your edge of your keyboard should also be cushioned, so that where that area is resting should find some cushioning.
Thank you, Doctor. We are entertaining a lot of audience question answers, so I'll request Apurva to take this forward. Hi, Apurva.
Hi, so ma'am, that was a very insightful session, sir. Now we have some audience questions and some general questions. So one thing is that we are not going out in the lockdown, right? And we are confined to our homes. And I don't think we get enough sunlight because we're not going out. Is sunlight important for bone health? And if yes, how can we compensate for that at home?
Typically, Apurva, I think there is no compensation for a sunlight. A sunlight is a must. And for any bone health, a bone health issue, we typically should focus on a calcium and the vitamin D. I think if we are keeping ourselves on an indoor due to lockdown or a work from home culture, definitely that vitamin D level of our body is going deficient. Typically, we Indians have chronically low level of vitamin D reported in our body. And this work from home culture is potentiating that effect. So for a sunlight, I would recommend a minimum half an hour of a sun exposure. And typically, that's what we are interested in, ultraviolet B rays of a sunlight, which are, necessary for our body's vitamin D to be get activated. Our skin have a cholesterol formulation that is a precursor of vitamin D that get activated with the UVB light, and a formation of an active vitamin D process starts. So on a sunlight, and typically that how much sunlight you should take typically if a person is in a light skin, the sunlight exposure need is less. If the person is in a dark skin person, the sunlight exposure would be a bit more. Similarly, for the young persons, the sunlight exposure is less, and for the elder people, sunlight exposure needs to be more. And typically, recommended timing for that is you should have at least 15 minutes to 1 hour of a sunlight exposure. For the darker skin people should need more. That's in a 1 hour of exposure kind of a thing. And the light skin people could have 15-20 minutes of a sunlight exposure to have a good amount of vitamin D in their body. And the sunlight exposure that is recommended is typical 10 a.m. to 3 p.m. kind of a sunlight that we recommend to have to get the best of vitamin D that is naturally coming to you. And none of the drug formulation can compensate that. And it has been found in the studies that if you are taking, you know, 15, 20 minutes of sunlight and taking 1,000 units of, you know, vitamin D drug, a sunlight exposure would give you, you know, a better amount or better bioavailability of an vitamin D rather than a 1,000 or 1,400 units of vitamin D you are taking as a drug.
That was very insightful. Like, I would, like, I also stay at home, so like I'll start going out in the sun for now. There's one question from Anil Sinha. There is a needle pain in my shoulder and neck whenever I type on the computer. This is a general question he has asked.
Needle pain on a
on my shoulder and neck when I type on my computer.
Okay. Typically, that's a very common phenomena. But I would recommend that if he is getting the pain that radiating up to fingers, that would be an, a sign of an, a nerve root irritation from the neck. I think in that case, he need to consult his doctor to get him screened for the radiculopathy, whether he might have disc, cervical disc related issue. And if he is working from home and he is, suppose he is not having that tingling or the numbness kind of a sensation in any of the finger, or just on a small arm twitch, or the majority of the pain is on the back of the neck or the neck, back of the shoulder and the neck. In that case, I think he should assess what are his seating and desking arrangement if he is working from home. And after getting awareness about that, what he should correct on his seating postural related issues, he should start doing some neck exercises or the shoulder exercises to get rid of that. And if that is not subsiding within a smaller painkiller or the muscle relaxant of few days courses, if that pain is not relieving, I think he should consult the doctor.
Thank you, doctor. The next question is by Arun Kumar Mishra. Which position should we sleep to avoid any shoulder, neck, shoulder or back pain? What is the ideal posture for sleeping?
That's a very good question, Apurva. And most of the people we see for the neck, shoulder pain or even the low back pain, they report early morning stiffness, early morning pain in the low back area or a neck area or the upper back area. Typically, that evaluation of this pain starts with whether you are getting pain while you are just going to bed, whether you are getting up and getting the pain, or you are feeling that pain in the whole day. So, while that upper neck or on the sleeping postures, I'm coming to that, typically that what kind of a mattress one should have, or a typical pillow you should have. We see in our practice that most of the people are sleeping without pillows if they are having a neck pain or upper back pain. They typically get an advice you should avoid using the pillow and sleep without that. And I typically suggest that this should be avoided. You have to use the proper pillow. Sleeping without pillow is a cause of a pain in the neck and the upper back. The typical pillow height that we suggest is typical shoulder width. Whatever is your shoulder width, that should be the ideal height of your pillow, and you should use that. So that typically while sleeping, if you are on sleeping on the side, neither your neck should be elevated or neither it should be going down. So while you are sleeping on sides, ask somebody to see you whether your neck is straight or not. Similarly, nowadays, if the people who, persons who are having some stiff neck issues or whose neck are issues, now very good cervical pillows are available that supports your neck curve. I think the person who is having a long-term neck issues, they should start using the cervical pillows that would support their neck curve. And similarly, on the mattress side, whatever that mattress you are using, the basic principle lies that the mattress should not give you the their curve. Ideally, that mattress should adapt to your curvature. That's the basic that we want. And whether you need a very softer version of a mattress or a firm, that is a personal choice. But we would normally advise on a firm base. On that, you could have a very good nowadays memory foam is available that takes your body curvature and does not put your body curvature on any of the strain. I think and for if you have a back pain, the sleeping posture we advise is while you are going to sleep, your initial 10 or 15 minutes, don't lie straight. When you are lying straight, just fold your knees. So that will relieve your back pain. Most of the people will get back pain when they sleep straight for a couple of minutes, 15, 20 minutes when they are going to bed. So the simpler trick is that either you should lie on the sides for initial 10 or 15 minutes, or if you're lying straight, just fold your knees for 10 or 15 minutes and that will relax your back muscles. I think that will take care of that pain.
Thank you, doctor. One question I had, I was very curious about was students when they used to go to school had a very heavy backpack that they used to carry with all the books. So students also have started hunching, which should not have been the case. Is there something, a posture correction that they can adopt?
Typically that every shoulder or every kid's shoulder has a threshold of, you can say that particular, if somebody is taking a 10 kg of a weight or a particular kid is taking 5 kg of a weight or a 15 kg of weight. I think every kid needs to be individually assessed for that. I think nowadays the teaching has been shifted to more or less a digital modes. Now the weight of book have been reduced as well. And the schools have also opted that you would be bringing less of a books on your bag. I think typically if your bag weight is more, the shoulder and the spine problem in kids are going to happen. There are no way out. Either you have to reduce the weight, and number two, either you make the kid's back strong enough to handle that weight. So I think that we have to work on both the sides. We have to work on how we can reduce the weight of a backpack. That should be our priority. And similarly, the number two objective is to how we can strengthen the back of the kids. In that also, the simple back exercises that we need to promote to kids. And for kids, I think a best exercise, what I could say is if the kid is doing swimming, I think that could be the best a back exercise that kids could have.
Next question is, which treatment is good for lower back and hip pain, orthopedic or chiropractic? Or is it specific to a person?
Apurva, I think it would be in a very broad answer if we would be discussing that.
Yes.
And I think there are a lot of things that are going in the brain of a doctor when you are coming up with any of the low back or a hip pain. Okay. So any of the manipulative treatment, if you are taking it yourself without knowing the reason of that pain, I think that is medically not recommended. And that pain needs to be evaluated. Lots of people go for a manipulative treatment of their own and they land up in bigger issues. So any pain you are having in your hip area or a lower back needs its due evaluation. Please don't do any manipulative activity before knowing the diagnosis. Otherwise, we might land up in a bigger issue as well.
Thank you, doctor. That was a very broad question. The next question is, what is sciatica? a lot of people, including my mom, has sciatica pain. And how can that be avoided or cured?
Typically, Apurva, that sciatica is an, a common term. Typically, we have an sciatic nerve. There is an, one big nerve that is coming from our gluteal region and going down to our legs. That's in a very big nerve that takes origin from our that has an origin from our lower vertebrae. In the spinal cord, we have a nerve roots. So that takes origin from the nerve roots of a lower spinal region, and it travels from your hip region and going down to the your leg, and its branches reach up to the you can say that your sole or a great toe. Okay, so that's the length of it, that nerve. If that nerve is getting irritated any point, either in the its origin from a lumbar vertebra level or the spinal cord level, or lower down in the hip region or anywhere in the its course, if that nerve is getting irritated, it sends a pain signal from your gluteal region to thighs, to calf, to your great toes. That is typically known as a sciatica, typically known as a sciatica in a common language. And it's also for an orthopedic doctor, it's in a broad terminology, and typically we label it as in a symptom. It is not in a diagnosis, it is not in a disease. That needs to be understood, that sciatica is not a disease. We take it as a sign that something is irritating the sciatic nerve. That's why the person is getting a pain in the lower limb, and that needs an evaluation.
Thank you, doctor. One question is, a lot of people typically travel in flights. So we get these neck pillows and all. If we travel internationally, are these recommended? Because, you know, international flights where people tend to sleep and they sleep in a wrong posture. So these neck pillows, are there any recommendations or?
Definitely, Apurva, these neck pillows help you to maintain the position of a neck. So that you should avoid an unaccustomed jerk to the neck, because any suppose that if you are in a sleep and your muscles get relaxed, and if you get in a jerk, that could be a very a painful jerk, and your neck area is very sensitive. If that can lead to any of the disc prolapse kind of an activity as well. So typical neck pillows, what we use in the flights, are typically recommended while you are sleeping. And the other thing would be that what I could recommend is during the long flights, we should do a 5 minutes kind of a stretching activity. Meanwhile, you can say that you can extend your neck, and you should do your neck movement so that you are stretching yourself in the long flights, along with using the neck pillows.
So one question is about heels and slippers on the chat box. So this is by Rekha Lal. She says, I have to wear slippers with soft soles only, or else I get pain. My right foot's pain has increased a lot. Is it because of wrong footwear?
Typically, these heel pains are due to that. What happens that there is a fascia known as a plantar fascia on the undersurface of your sole that gets attached to your heel bone. And where this fascia is getting attached to the heel bone, you have a chronic stress or a strain there, and that part gets inflamed. So most of the time, that pain is due to plantar fasciitis, or you can say that bone spur in that area that causes you a pain in that area. Typically, what we recommend is if you are in an overweight, you should use in a very cushioned footwear. Nowadays, silicone gels are also available. Silicone heel cups are also available, where you can use for a support in that area. Cushion footwear, there is no alternative to that. For the heel pain, you have to use the cushion footwear, and typically what we see in a clinical practice that ladies footwear is typically a hard sole one in the heel area, because a fashion could not guarantee you a softer version of an softer cushions in the heel area. So if somebody is having heel pain, try to get the convenience first, then the fashion. And number two, if you are having a heel pain, you have to do constant stretching of your calf muscles and the plantar fascia. That is recommended while you are standing. Just stand on your toes and then go on a heel. This activity you can do 15 or 20 times whenever you are, you can say that, coming from a resting position. Just be on toes, then on heel. So that will stretch your calf muscles. And the other, the plantar fascia stretching that you can do is while you are seating and with your extended leg, and you can use any towel or a cloth to stretch your forefoot with that cloth. So that will extend your plantar fascia. Typically, these non-medicative measures work typically well in the heel pain. And if they fail, if you are not doing that properly, you are not stretching your calf muscles and plantar fascia. Typically, if I would be having that heel pain, I will try to get rid of that without any pharmacological means. So I will treat it myself without medicines with these stretching exercises only. But sometimes what happens that if these measures fail, we might need anesthetics for a couple of weeks, or sometimes a steroid injection on the heel. That's the next steps that you might need.
One question was about calcium supplements. So these are like calcium sandals, and a lot of calcium supplements are like available freely in the market, and people have started taking them and thinking, you know, these are like health fads, so they keep coming and going. So are these recommended? Who should or who should not take calcium supplements?
Typically, Apurva, that our daily allowance of calcium in the body, that varies with a person to person, varies with age, varies with in a females, if in the pregnancy status, post-pregnancy status, or a post-menopausal status. So typically, whatever our diet's calcium intake is you can say that typical vegetarian diet we are taking. If I take it as an adolescent girl, I think if we want to avoid the calcium supplementation in an older age group, typically in the females, I think our activity should start during the childhood or during the adolescent age. Typically, that our peak bone mass, what we call it as a bone, should achieve the maximum calcium density in females typically during the adolescence or by the age of 20. So if any girl child is deficient in a calcium diet during adolescence, she would have a peak bone mass less. Okay. And during a menopause, the bone mass, which is already not in optimum, is getting demineralized. So I think for the girls, during adolescence or the growth time phase, we should focus on calcium supplementation so that they can attain optimum bone mass during that time. That should be our first activity that I would recommend to reduce the incidence of osteopenia or osteoporosis in the later age group. The second is the pregnancy time. Most of the ladies take calcium and iron very regularly on the pregnancy, in the 9 months time. They take very regularly. But what happens that during the post-pregnancy time, during lactation, during that post-delivery 1 or 1.5 or 2 years, during that they are lactating, they usually forget to take the calcium. And I just wanted to put the fact that the calcium need of an lactating mother is almost double of a pregnant woman. Okay, so a lactating mother needs a calcium supplementation, and that needs to be taken care of to avoid demineralization of his own bones. That should be taken care of. And similarly, the postmenopausal woman, because due to the hormonal lag, they start demineralizing their skeleton. So we need a vitamin D or calcium supplementation to reduce their bones fragility. And similarly, for the men's also, we don't focus usually on the men's skeleton issue, because we think that males have usually good calcium in their bones. But with under exposure of a sunlight, now we are seeing that the osteoporosis is on rise on the males as well. So the other thing that we would recommend is for males, you get your vitamin D level checked, get your BMD checked when you are over 40. If we find that it is in osteopenia, definitely the male should also get the calcium supplementation and the vitamin D.
One last question was about these health drinks like Bonvita, Horlicks, that you claim to, you know, increase height in kids in like by taking it daily. So is this possible?
I think that's a big no. If you are getting any of these supplements for getting your increasing your height, or supposing that your height will be increased with these supplements, I think the answer, scientific answer, is big no. Your height is predetermined genetically, and that's a non-modifiable factor at your end.
There was one question that one person, he says that he has suffering from L4, L5 back pain on and off, and has been on medication, but there's no permanent solution for this back pain, and will I have to live with it forever? And can he play badminton or any sports activity with this type of back pain? Two questions.
Basically that he is narrating in an L4, L5 disc issue. Typically that disc issue, which is causing a back pain, is more or less I think that would be an instability issue if he is facing. Typically that disc issue where we want to intervene are the disc issues which are getting radiating pain to your lower limbs, or it is affecting your nerve function, or you have a tingling, numbness, or some kind of a weakness on your lower limb. These are the area where we act surgically after MRI. And if you are having only a back pain, I would like you to suggest that meet your orthopedic doctor, so that he will evaluate the cause. And if we can help you on that side, if you have an instability, I think there are you might get relief from the back strengthening exercises as well. And if unfortunately there is a large instability in the lumbar spine area, they may offer you some of the other variety of the treatment, like some braces or a surgery. I think he needs to consult the doctor if he is having a chronic pain in the lower lumbar region.
He's written all doctors have advised core back muscle exercises as solution.
Yeah, that's I think so that is more or less, and he has to focus on the I think that he would be having a mechanical lower back pain. For that, it is recommended that you have to follow the muscle strengthening exercises, and similarly you have to take care of your postures, that while you are sitting or sleeping, you have to take care of your postures to get rid of this pain.
Thank you for answering the questions, doctor. It was a very insightful session. Okay, a lot of people have written a lot of good comments, and they have learned a lot from you in the chat box. Thank you so much, everyone, for joining and for asking such wonderful questions. If there is anything else, we can take them up with the doctor, and you can let us know. We can connect you with him, or thank you. And I would like to hand over the session to Swati to close the session. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Apurva. Thank you, Simran. I think great work from both of you. Thank you so much, Dr. Nitin. I think everybody who is present in this session has really appreciated the suggestions and, you know, the recommendations that you have given for different kind of problems, because I think these look like very minor problems these days, but over the period of time they cause severe damage to the vertebra and the spine. So I think everybody has learned a lot of things, including me. I was not aware that, you know, they need to be the chair need to be at 90 degree, and you know, the laptop has to be around, you know, at the eye level and so on. And these are like very small things that we ignore in our daily lives and keep working because we feel the work is important, we have to get the things out. But behind the doing the work, these small things are so important that, you know, actually keeps you healthy for a long term. So I think that was a great session. In fact, one of the person who have joined has also written that, I do not have any question, but this is to compliment you, Dr. Nitin, for a very clear answer and simple explanation. Experts like you can help the society on prevention part against cure. Well done, thanks. So
thank you.
From all of us. Thank you so much. And thank you, audience, for joining us. We will be coming out with such sessions every Sunday for you, catering to different kind of health problems. Thank you for joining us this session. And now we'll be closing the session. Have a wonderful day ahead. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.